We begin with a problem. I've got two minds about my faith. Don't be scared. We're gonna do a little drama today. I want to let you hear what goes on in my head. To try to impress upon you the contrast when I'm speaking from doubt, I'm gonna look like this. And when I speak with more faith and conviction, I'll go clean-shaven. Fighters to your corners, let's dance.
Round one, fight!
How does God love you? God loves me. That's it. That's all I need to go on. We've talked about this before. Christianity does equal the best possible worldview for me, because it is the only description of the universe that incorporates a ruler of the universe that actually cares for everybody, and not just in the abstract way, but in a meaningful, self-sacrificing way.
How does God love you? Everyone in your life who says they love you shows up. They talk to you. You have a relationship with them. God doesn't speak auditorily to you, so you have to pretend that what you have is a relationship. You have to pretend that God doesn't use your five senses to interact with you, but somehow speaks to you wordless nothings.
I may not have heard an auditory voice of the Spirit, felt a physical touch from the Father, or seen the face of the Son, but many have. You can't just throw out the eyewitness accounts of the apostles. And what of the millions of folks that experience God from dreams and visions?
There are, of course, two answers to the why can't I talk with God conundrum. Either he's not there,
but the eyewitnesses,
or the problem is you, Dante. You're too sinful, too self-involved, too long gone. You already admitted you're a hypocrite. You're a liar, too. And John the Revelator says, "But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death."
Sir?
All liars. How many of those labels fit you?
Yes, but for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I can't separate myself.
And then what does Paul say in the very next chapter?
I knew you were going to throw Romans 9 at me.
Yes! Because it's just as valid as Romans 8. The easiest read is to understand that Paul is talking to God's many Jacobs in chapter 8. But you're an Esau. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. Then the death blow. What if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the object of his wrath, prepared for destruction? The equation is simple enough. You don't feel God's love because you are not chosen. You are not elect. You are not loved, but merely a vessel of wrath, being meticulously prepared for destruction.
You know, Satan tried to do a similar thing with Jesus.
Look! Look, look! Look at me! We could be twins, no?
Tried to leverage scripture to chuck sand in his eyes.
I didn't write these words. You can make me the scapegoat all you want. These are his words, are they not?
You cite Romans 9, which in turn, when referencing Jacob and Esau, is citing Malachi 1:1-3.
Which reads,
"Glad you asked. I have loved you, says the Lord. But you ask, how have you loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, declares the Lord. Yet I have loved Jacob, but Esau I have hated, and I have turned his hill country into a wasteland, and left his inheritance to the desert jackals." See, Malachi is actually making the opposite point of what you're saying. The emphasis isn't on Esau, but it's on Jacob. The whole Jacob/Esau thing comes up because Israel is openly doubting God and his love for them.
That's a weird way to tell someone you love them. You're questioning my love? Just look at how much I hate that dude over there compared to you. And even in the context of Malachi, God talks about love almost entirely by focusing on what he does to those he apparently doesn't love.
And, recall, the argument isn't that God is never loving, just that he doesn't love you.
You're me too.
I'll concede that point.
Okay, how about Malachi 4:2? But for you who revere my name, the Sun of Righteousness will rise with healing in its rays, and you will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. Frolic! We get to frolic! And I do revere God. If that's the test, then we're okay.
Unless you've blasphemed the Spirit.
Oh, low blow.
It's textual. Jesus says it. How is it not a legitimate argument?
Okay, fine. Read the text to me.
Matthew 12:31. The words of Jesus.
Really rubbing it in.
Therefore, I say to you, any sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven people, but blasphemy against the Spirit shall not be forgiven.
In response, I'll direct you to a one Mr. Kenneth Birding, professor at Biola University, our alma mater.
Hallowed be her name.
Anywho, Birding wrote an entire article about this very subject. The second and third paragraphs of that article read, "It is unlikely that this young woman had committed the unforgivable sin. She loved the Lord and wanted her life to please him, but she apparently didn't understand what blasphemy against the Holy Spirit was, and thereby came to worry that she might have committed the unforgivable sin. What is the blasphemy against the Spirit? What is the unforgivable sin? Let me offer a definition at the outset. Blasphemy against the Spirit, the unforgivable sin, is ongoing hardening of your heart against the Holy Spirit who is trying to lead you to repent of sin and believe in Christ. Furthermore, it is an issue of the heart that manifests in your words."
Notice how he begins. It is unlikely. Not, it is impossible.
Let the reader decide. The article and Birding's full explanation is in the description. To paraphrase, Birding's argument appears to be that the unforgivable sin is the continual hardening of the heart. But that doesn't describe us. We struggle. Of course we struggle. But we're going down with the boat.
It's too easy. We haven't been tested.
How do you mean?
We currently live in Dallas, Texas. The friggin' buckle of the Bible Belt. Being a Christian costs nothing here. I read your Biolin article. The author quotes Luke 12:8 and 9. "And I say to you, everyone who confesses me before men, the Son of Man will confess him also before the angels of God. But he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God." It's too easy to confess Christ in a Christian culture. Go live in medieval Japan and get back to me.
That's not fair.
And what is? Huh? What is?
I can't defend myself against imaginary scenarios. You and I both have thought about this ad nauseum. Yes, I believe every man has a breaking point. Yes, I believe every person on earth, besides God himself, would deny Christ under enough torture, under enough torment. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm just scared that I would break when others wouldn't. But I also know that until you're in those tremendous situations, you can't speak for yourself. Some things have to be lived.
I still find it a little bit telling that the best article, the best deference to authority you can point to still, can only say it is unlikely she blasphemed the Spirit. That's not a lot of confidence, is it?
The persistent widow. Okay, she asks and asks and asks and eventually gets her way. Jesus says if we act like her with him, he'll open his arms. He'll let us in.
Yeah, that's a good one. But you know where I'm going with the next one.
Yeah, I do.
The podcast Judge John Hodgman features the comedian John Hodgman deciphering the crux of folks' tiffs. A repeated mantra of his is that it does, in fact, hurt to ask. We've got that saying, right? It doesn't hurt to ask, but it does. You know this. Praying for something over and over again, when the problem is not solved, it hurts. It hurts to ask God for it to be healed over and over and over again. There's a cost to asking. There's an apocryphal story we heard long ago. I don't know if it's true, but the story goes that Dave Matthews of the famed Dave Matthews Band asked his girlfriend to marry him like 4 times. Each time she denied it. Supposedly, the song Halloween was birthed out of his pain. It hurts to ask. It hurts to be the persistent widow.
Yeah, so what? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Whether it hurts or not is not part of the equation. You know this. One of our favorite books is A Prayer for Owen Meany. It ends, after hundreds of pages of story, with a desperate but repetitive refrain. Oh God, please give him back. I shall keep asking you.
You know who kept asking? King Saul. He was so desperate, he raised up Samuel, the prophet of God, from the dead, just so he could encounter God again. But God had turned his back on him, had he not? Did not Saul blaspheme the Spirit? Was he not too far gone when he kept asking?
You're making this hyper-focused on us. Read A Purpose-Driven Life, man. It's not about us. It's about him. It's about God's goodness.
Okay, let's go back to Malachi, shall we?
I don't like your tone.
You shouldn't.
Oh, boy.
Behold, I will rebuke your offspring and spread dung on your faces, the dung of your offerings, and you shall be taken away with it.
Would that this hoodie were a time hoodie?
Okay. I can't hide. All I can do is rest in one principle. It's the same principle that Sir Thomas More states at the end of A Man for All Seasons. As More is led to the executioner, he tells the executioner,
"Be not afraid of your office. You send me to God."
The archbishop presiding over More's murder says,
"You're very sure of that, Sir Thomas?"
"He will not refuse one who is so blithe to go to him."
I have to hold to that same premise. I so want to see God. Okay?
Okay.